Okay, hi. Welcome to Taiwanese Lutheran Church English Service. Good morning. We welcome you all here from online. This is worship.
Thank you. Welcome. Thank you for joining us on this online worship. It's hard to believe that today we are celebrating Palm Sunday and under the threat of the COVID-19 virus. I still remember last year we were here to celebrate the Lord's riding donkey into the city of Jerusalem, his coronation, and there about 30 or 40 some people here together, and today there are only six of us. But I trust that there are much more who are joining our worship online, thanks to the technology, but thanks to the Lord's wonderful will, and in that, the viewing of our worship, Sunday school, and in small group, that they are much more than before. And then we never imagined, we can never think of God's wonderful will, and that He continued to spread out His word, His worship, His prayers, and then through the internet. And unfortunately, the virus cannot go through the internet, so we are safe. Let's go to the Lord with a word of prayer, and then we lift up those who are sick in God's hand. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you that we can worship here. We thank you that we can worship over the internet. We thank you that we can worship in our living room. We can worship outdoors, indoors. There's no limit because you are an omnipresent God. And you are omniscient God. You are omnipotent God. You know what's in our heart. The coronavirus cannot be the hindrance for our worship. We want to come before you and worship you, because you deserve our worship. It is so natural to you for who you are, for your grace, for your love for us. And it's the most natural way for us to respond is to worship you. So we thank you for this opportunity. And I trust that through our worship, you'll meet with us. You'll meet with us in our prayers, in our listening to your words. May you achieve what you want to achieve in our worship. May your heart be pleased, and may your name be lifted high, and may all those worshippers can be transformed by you. Lord, we lift up those who are suffering from this virus pandemic. We pray those family who lost their loved ones. We pray for those family who are still struggling and still fighting. Lord, we pray for your mercy to be with those families. We pray that because in difficulty that people's hearts are softened, so they know that the human beings are so fragile and the human technology just cannot be depended upon. And then because of that, people will come, will turn toward you, will seek for their relationship with you. Lord, you always want people to get to know you and receive eternal life. We pray that you achieve this wonderful will in this seemingly disaster, a plague. Lord, we also lift up our brothers and sisters in your hand. We pray for your protection. We pray that you strengthen everyone. Give everyone a strong immune system to resist any bacterial virus. Lord, we lift up Dominic in your hand. We sure don't know what the true problem of those symptoms are, but the Lord, you know, you are the great physician. We pray that the power of the Holy Spirit will be with him. Give him the strength so that he can completely recover as soon as possible. We also pray for your protection for Pastor P, for Jill, and then for Sienna. And that they will be protected, they will not be affected, and the entire family can soon rejoice in great health, rejoice in for your grace. Pray for Cindy, who is going to have a brain tumor surgery tomorrow morning, early morning. Lord, I would pray that you will protect her and be with her, give her the most successful surgery, and then that she can also recover soon. Now we lift up our worship in your hand, the remaining of worship. Prepare our heart to listen to your word. And I thank you, I pray all of these in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Turn the time to my teacher, my dear friend, And then my mentor, Dr. Smith, he's going to share with you the message on Palm Sunday.
Ready? Good morning. Welcome to Taiwanese Lutheran Church as we continue to worship and serve the Lord. I'm Pastor Jim Smith, Dr. Smith, Bethel Seminary. So honored that Pastor Albert would invite me to be up here at this time. Now, I've been up here several times, and I know from experience that this is a good and a gracious people. And I don't just love you for the food. This is a wonderful place. But I know that somewhere out there, wherever you're sitting, there are several people that are saying, put the mask back on, Dr. Smith, because you look better with a mask. I understand that, but I'm going to keep it off here because I want to make sure that the word of the Lord is heard clearly and that we're able to celebrate His presence. I'm so grateful for the arrangement here with the worship team and their inspiration, and now this beautiful background that we have here on a spring morning, Palm Sunday, here in this place, and we're going to enter in to that spirit by God's own spirit and enjoy this. So the mask stays off for a while, but we're going to be looking at the Word. Allow me to read the word of the Lord, John chapter 12, verses 12 and following. This is Palm Sunday. On the next day, a great multitude who had come to the feast, when they had heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, they took the branches of the palm trees and went out to meet him and began to cry out, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel. And Jesus, finding a young donkey, sat upon it, as it's written, Fear not, daughter of Zion. Behold, your king comes sitting on a donkey's colt. These things his disciples did not understand at the first. But when Jesus was glorified, they then remembered that these things were written of him, and that they had done these things to him. And so the multitude who were with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him up from the dead, were bearing him witness. For this cause also the multitude went and met him, because they heard that he had performed this sign. The Pharisees therefore said to one another, You see, that we're not doing any good. Look, the whole world has gone after him. Now there were certain Greeks among those who were going up to worship at the feast, and these therefore came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida of Galilee, and began to ask him, saying, Sir, we wish to see Jesus. Well, Philip came and told Andrew. Andrew and Philip came, and they told Jesus. And Jesus answered them, saying, The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Truly I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains by itself alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. He who loves his life loses it, and the one who releases his life in this world shall keep it to life eternal. If anyone serves me, well, then let them follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be. If anyone serves me, the Father will honor them. Now my soul has become troubled. What will I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, for this purpose I came to this hour. Father, glorify thy name. And there came therefore a voice out of heaven, saying, I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again. The multitude, therefore, who stood by and heard it, were saying it thundered, and some said, it's an angel. But Jesus said, this voice was not for my sake, but it was for yours. So it is today. This is the word of the Lord, and we give thanks to God. Now we have called, as Pastor Albert's made available, the teaching notes for this morning to you online, and you can follow along as you may wish. But most deeply, Lord, we pray that in your word we'll find a word for us. We'll find a message for us. We'll find by your Spirit's illumination that there is light upon our feet, a light unto our path, as the psalmist said. Show us where we're standing in this moment, and show us which way we should follow and proceed with you. Glory to you, now and forever. Amen. Now we've called this teaching the Passions of Palm Sunday. The Passions of Palm Sunday. And it is the case that the word passion in modern English language has a lot of different ways of expression. Depending on what generation you're from, passion might be called excitement. It might be called what turns you on, what floats your boat, what gets you going, what pumps you up. What motivates you? Passion, excitement, electricity in the air. And in this Palm Sunday narrative, we find that there are certainly illustrations of that. The first illustration, as we find in verses 12 to 19, is the passion of the parade. The passion of the parade. It is a passion of celebration. Celebration by a crowd that had gathered to declare this event, and to declare the entrance of Jesus. Now, for this group of Jewish believers, rooted in the Old Testament promise, from Moses to the prophets and on, there was no doubt as they saw this amazing, amazing person, Jesus, the human face of God. When they saw this entrance into Jerusalem and him riding upon a colt, upon a donkey, they saw a fulfillment of the prophecy of Zechariah chapter 9 and verse 9 that said, behold, as we have read, behold, your king comes sitting upon a donkey's colt. What a marvelous fulfillment. What an incredible scene. Let me pause for a moment and say very simply that there have been, I think, three great parades that I've witnessed in my life. When I was just a kid in 1963, I was part of a procession of a motorcade in which President John F. Kennedy came to San Diego. It was June of 1963. He was on his way to San Diego State University to do the commencement, and the crowd was wild and celebrative, and I was part of that, and I'd still think he waved just at me. JFK was here. I saw the parade. There was another parade some years later. We moved to Boston, and the Pope was coming. And there in a significantly Catholic city in its heritage, there was the Pope in a motorcade, and we had our oldest boy on our shoulders up in the north end of Boston, and we were waving, and the crowd was going wild and saying things in English, Irish, Latin, you name it. What a parade. And then we were in Minnesota, where I pastored as well, and the Minnesota Twins won the World Series in 1987, and I was part of a parade. And here came the team in a motorcade, and the crowd was going crazy, and it was a wonderful time. There's an old song, a Hollywood song, I love a parade. Well, they love this parade. But it's also the case, if we can take a deep breath, we'll say not everyone in that crowd that welcomed JFK was a Democrat. And not everyone, including myself, who welcomed the Pope to Boston was Roman Catholic. And not even everyone who celebrated that World Series winning team in Minnesota was really a Twins fan. They really kind of wanted somebody else but to do it. But oh, the excitement was there. The passion of the parade is there. It's a passion with fulfillment, but also descent. There are dissenters. There are cynics. There are critics in the crowd. There are naysayers. And the text says, on one hand, it's those who officially accustomed to religious power, as the Pharisees were, officially opposed him and tried everything they could to undermine Jesus' ministry. And in this moment of desperation, they said, oh, the whole world's gone after him. We're not doing anything here. We're not getting anywhere. Dissent that was visible. But also in the crowd, there was the dissent person by person, may I say, of those with expectations, those with requirements. My wife Linda and I talk about those who have a degree of oughtness in their personality. This is the way it ought to be. This is the kind of Messiah Jesus ought to be. And so as I turn and pick up a couple of palms for a moment, these are palms taken with permission from neighbors in our neighborhood. With permission, let me say. I'm an honest man, all right? But just like these palms, yeah, they're both part of the species, but they're very different in their contour, very different in their growth patterns. The individuality is still there. And as they wave the palms, some were waving one personality and one expectation, and some were waving the other. Isn't that true of humanity? That expectation. There was dissent there, and Jesus knew it. He came there into the Palm Sunday events, entered the holy city, fulfillment of prophecy, because of his great love. And despite opposition, despite the mixed motives, there was Jesus at the center of this passion of parade. There's a second kind of passion, and we see it in the text here where it says in verse 20 and following, that there were those in the crowd who were not, shall we say, native Jewish people. They were not descendants of Abraham, but they were people who were Greeks. They were what are called Hellenistic Jews from the Greek-speaking in the Roman Empire world. And they said, with a passion of pursuit, we want to see Jesus. We want to meet him. And this is the passion, may we say this morning, of investigation. The passion that the Greeks showed was, I want to look deeper. I want to get more personal. It may be that some of them, as Greek-speaking Jewish followers in the tradition, were seeking the fulfillment of the promise made in Jeremiah 29:13. If with all your heart you truly seek me, you will ever surely find me. Thus saith the Lord. Well, that's true then. And that's true now, as we look up to the Lord, as we lift up our eyes to him. But there were among these Greeks then, there were these expectations, these hopes that God would surely blossom as a deeper reality, as a presence, as a relationship in their lives. But no doubt they came as a subset of that larger crowd with their own expectations. Maybe because we're Greeks, because he is the Word made flesh and dwelt among us, maybe he'll speak philosophically. Maybe he'll bring a little philosophy into our Greek-speaking mind. Maybe he'll be this little cleverness. There's some rhetoric. Or maybe because we're Greeks and we don't like the Romans that much, maybe he's going to come and form this power that'll just mow down the Roman authority in this place. We don't know. We can't read their minds. But again, there is a passion of pursuit, but to what extent would they follow Jesus? Hitting their disappointments with Jesus having a different kingdom agenda. How far would they follow him? When would they begin to drop off? When would they begin to backbite, to scratch, to scrap? When would they begin? That extent is compelling. Jesus had seen that already, as Matthew 11 says, all the way back in the earlier part of his ministry when people were talking about John the Baptist. And Jesus said, what did you go out to see? What were you really looking for when you went to see John? This reed blowing in the wind, what were you going out to see? A prophet? How did that work? Well, these people, as the pop song goes from years ago, I saw the sign, right? They had seen the signs and the wonders, And then and now, often people want more. That's the mantra, more. How far would they follow? There was a passion of pursuit here, but to what extent? So we have a crowd that is cheering and celebrating, but underneath that, there's dissent. We have individuals who come and they say to followers of our Lord, we would see Jesus, but there is in the midst of that passion of pursuit, what extent will they follow? See, both of these earlier meanings, as we said at the very beginning of our time together, both of those reflect, in a sense, something that's timeless in our contemporary mind. It's passion is excitement. It's being pumped up. It's being turned on. It's being floated up. But what Jesus came deeply in his heart was not a negation of excitement, but an affirmation of a deeper, an ancient meaning of passion. As it says in your notes, the Latin word passio means at its heart a willingness to suffer for what you love. A willingness to suffer for what you love. Some years ago, I was privileged to be part of a group that gathered up at Rick Warren's church for a screening, 2004, of the movie The Passion of the Christ. What a powerful film. Some of you may even want to see that in some form. It was in the dialogue on screen in the original languages, back and forth. There are English subtitles, no Mandarin, I'm sorry. But maybe there is a Mandarin edition out there. In any case, with that, there are the last 12 hours of Jesus' life. That is the passion of the Christ. In that particular audience, it was a privilege to have the one who'd helped create that film, Mel Gibson, the actor, was there in the group and standing about 20 feet over to my left. And as the movie played with this screening, which ultimately our church would buy hundreds of tickets for and give out to our neighbors so they could sense the passion of the Christ back in that time. And some of them made commitments to follow Jesus. But in that time, what an amazing moment, passion. In its ancient meaning, this third meaning, the passion of the Passover lamb, a willingness to suffer for what we love. And that's not just celebration. It's not only investigation. It's dedication. It's Jesus saying yes to his Heavenly Father's deepest purposes, which would meet our deepest needs. The fulfillment of prophecy, it's there. He comes riding on a colt, fulfillment of Zechariah. He comes prepared to open a way by which those who seek him would truly find him, Jeremiah 29. But here it's Isaiah 53, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. You know, as we enter into this Holy Week, what a wonderful time to go back and read familiar passages of Scripture. When I get home, one of the things I want to do this Palm Sunday afternoon is go back and read Isaiah 53, and I will say, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And just like the worship team said earlier, I will respond by grace to say, here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God, you're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. What a wonderful fulfillment of prophecy, Jesus coming in. And in that, may we say, is Jesus kind of cruising? Is he riding the tide of opinion? No, earlier in the Gospels it said he could look deeply to this one and that one and see some of the motives that were there, some of the dissent, some of the limited extent. This is Jesus who is in this moment seeing and sensing and feeling the full situation long before he gets to the cross in this Holy Week. Verse 27, now my soul has become troubled. What will I say? Jesus is feeling the weight of this moment, the pressure, the burden of being the Lamb of God. Of being someone who, as he could look into the eyes of the crowd, knew that there was a betrayal ahead. And so our Lord Jesus, looking deeply, could say, with so much honesty that the Apostle John picked up on it, right? It's recorded in his gospel. My soul is troubled. That's a powerful Greek word. That's the word that's used for storms. The word that's used for earthquakes. My soul is shaking because of the power of this moment. Jesus felt it. The passion of the Christ. As the Holy Week begins, what will I say? How amazing it is that God gives us the power of choice. And here the Son of God is saying to his Heavenly Father, what am I going to say? Beam me up? Mow them down? No. No. For this cause I came to this day. Glorify your name. Glorify your name. What an incredible moment of choice. Glorify your name. Let me say very simply, as a brief illustration, as we're drawing toward a close this morning, that one of my heroes, I have heroes, I teach church history, some of you know, but I have every congregation I've served, that Boston congregation, Minneapolis, San Diego, I'm associate pastor here in San Diego, down in the La Jolla area. Everywhere I've gone, there have been people that in some way or other were awesome examples to me. They were people of passion. They were people whose passion was centered on the Lord, and they made that choice. One of those dear people in my life is a woman in her 90s. Her name is Dr. Edith Eger, E-G-E-R. She is a Messianic Jewish woman who lives here in San Diego. I've seen her speak twice. I actually spoke to her on the phone about a week ago in these times. And she wrote a book called The Choice. Why? Because she was faced with a choice when she was in Auschwitz prison camp. I think I'm having a hard day because I have to wear a mask. Yeah? But think about being in Auschwitz and her family was exterminated there as part of the Holocaust. This book that she's written as a Jewish woman who celebrates Jesus and has been through it all says, called The Choice. You might even want to take a look at that. Powerful book. But she would point us to Jesus and to Jesus' choice. He who was full of grace and truth, not full of something else. Whether it's ego, self-acclaim, Jesus, in this Passion of the Christ, inspires our praise and our discipleship as this Palm Sunday signals a Holy Week just ahead. May we walk with him and delight in him. Jesus said in Mark 8:34, if anyone, and the Greek for that means anyone, if anyone would come after me, let them deny themselves. Doesn't mean we put down ourselves. It doesn't mean we do a worm theology, but it means we find our humility before the Lord as we bow and worship and listen and respond by grace faithfully. If anyone would come after me, let them deny themselves. Let them take up their cross and follow me. That cross may be in part the shape of serving others during this time of a virus in a wise way. I talked to my nephew yesterday who's a doctor. He's got his hands full up in the Bay Area. But he says, God is my strength. He is our strength. Here we are in this time. And so on this Palm Sunday, as we draw now to a close, you know I'm a historian. Pastor Albert had to put up with this in school, and now we're here, and I am warmed by his smiles back to me, as he is part of an audience of two here this morning. I want to do something historical, as the notes suggest. There's a hymn, a Palm Sunday hymn that was written, we think, the best of our reckoning in the year 820 by a Christian celebrant named Theodulf of Orleans. 820, what does that make it? That means this year is his 1200th anniversary of this hymn. I'd like to sing it for you. And then we'll celebrate God's goodness as we step into this Holy Week, not cheering or jeering only, Not simply saying, I want to look again, look deeper, I got a need to know. We act on the faith and the knowledge that we have. And from that point, the Lord leads us forward by His grace and His passion. Here's the hymn, if we may, is called All Glory, Laud, and Honor to Thee, Redeemer King. Forgive my voice. If it's mediocre, I'll just blame it on what's in the air. But it goes something like this. All glory, Laud, and honor to Thee, Redeemer King, to whom the lips of children made sweet hosannas ring. Thou art the King of Israel, Thou David's royal son, who in the Lord's name cometh, the King and Blessed One. The company of angels are praising Thee on high, and mortal ones, yes, all things created make reply. The people of the Hebrews with palms before Thee went. Our praise, our prayer, and anthems before Thee we present. To Thee before Thy passion they sang their hymns of praise. To Thee now high exalted our melodies we raise. Thou didst accept their praises, accept the praise we bring. Who in all good delightest, Thou good, Thou gracious King. Amen. Amen. Welcome to this Palm Sunday. And whatever our passions, we bow before the passion of the Christ, He who was willing to suffer because of His great love for us. Let us go forward wherever we are. In spirit, we are united as a people and with people all over the world who declare Jesus Christ is Lord. Lord, may it be so by Your grace. Instill in us by Your word, by Your example, by Your ongoing grace, Your beauty in motion in our lives, that we might be followers of Yours and make us wise in these times. Wise to make the very most of every opportunity. We ask this in Your name today, Holy God, the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you all.
Great appreciation on behalf of the church to Dr. Smith for coming to share God's word with us. And then I give Dr. Smith an option just to record it and then send the file over. But he's still willing to take the risk and then come over here. And then now may I remind you the invitation by Dr. Smith that in this coming Passion Week or Holy Week, now would you follow the footsteps of Jesus Christ day by day by reading the scriptures and contemplate on His love for you, and then contemplate on your relationship with Him, and then if appropriate, recommit yourself to our Lord Jesus Christ and then celebrate this eternal relationship with Him. And now I have a few announcements. And then please continue, the bulletin is being emailed to you. So please continue to lift up Dominic and any our brother and sister who are suffering from flu-like symptoms, and then just lift them up to the Lord and ask for the healing. Oh, I forget that I have a beautiful mask on. When I am talking, I should. Okay, this is a kind of reminder that for the health of everybody, we like everyone when you come to the church when you enter the church premises, please wash your hands and put on a mask. We put a clean mask at the entrance of the kitchen. So by all means, please wear it for your protection and for everyone else's protection. And then follow the guideline that's available in your bulletin. Just keep yourself healthy. Mm-hmm. When you keep yourself healthy, you're responsible to God who have given us this great body that we can function and then serve Him. And then you also are responsible to your family and then to the church. So please don't take this lightly. Keep this and good hygiene habit so you can be protected. Continue to be in prayer for those who are suffering. And then encourage you that while we are not meeting face to face, and you know that many people, we have many more people who are watching the Sunday worship and teachings, Sunday school teachings, and then joining online meetings. That we have a lot more participants than before. We give thanks to the Lord, and then I pray that the caring function and teaching function of the church would not be hindered at all and even expanded in much greater than before. And continue to remind you that we are in the 3 weeks of fasting, a prayer to pray for this pandemic situation that can be leaving soon, and then that the Lord's protection to be with us, and then His will be done. So follow those prayer items. Welcome you to join us, just one meal a day, and then so they can focus on prayer. And this week, a Bible reading, 1 Corinthians chapter 5-9. Read the Bible, and then read the question and answer that we send out to you as part of your daily routine. And then for all the youth, our young people, that we have a list of activity that we are suggesting to you. We'd like you to pick up all this activity that can fill out your week. And then next Friday, we're going to help you to put on your calendar. And I heard many people say, I'm bored. That is a dangerous word for me. When some people do not have a time to sleep, and then we have a time to be bored. So according to the Bible, we want to make the most out of our time that the Lord given to us, right? You know, so at the end of this pandemic situation, that we look back and say, wow, I have done this much. Praise the Lord, I did not waste time at all. So more details will follow. We'll help you and we will push you to do all these works. And then after the service, after the worship service, join us 11:20, the Sunday school. We'll continue our apologetic series, What is Life? The second half of chapter 1 will be led by Will and the angel. Thank you for their kindness, being willing to accept the teaching responsibility. And Sister Christy Chan, who is our dentist, she donated 200 face masks, surgical face masks, mm-hmm. Very high quality. So if you need it, send me a private line or text message. I'll try to mail that to you, so to avoid contact. And then continue to function, so you can send over your offering by mailing. Just use the regular mail. And now with all that, we conclude our worship, and I'd like to invite you all to stand and then receive the benediction. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love from our Heavenly Father, and the communion from the Holy Spirit be with you all, from now on until eternity. Amen.
Amen.
Now go in peace, go to your missions field. Amen.
Thanks be to God. Good.
Thank you, Dr. Smith.
You're welcome. I hope that fits.
Chinese way, thank you, Dr. Smith.
Good. Did good.
Now we have something to remind them this coming week. What they should do.
Good. Thank you.
Yeah. All right. And then I'm going to prepare for Mandarin and Chinese service. Okay. Only you can do that. Yeah, and then tell her you did not touch any of the.
Okay, thank you, Dr. James Smith, for the service in honor of Palm Sunday. We're doing Hosanna.
Thank you.